Hello and a very good morning to all of you. I hope and pray that all of you are keeping well. I hope that everything is going on well with you. Hope that you are safe. Hope that you had a great week. Yeah, I hope a lot of things. All right, so welcome to our Sunday Morning Fellowship. I'm really happy that you have been able to join along with our fellow members of the Church of Jesus Christ in studying the scripture and glorifying him through our songs and through our study of the scripture. So welcome. And let us start with a word of prayer. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for helping us to connect together as a church, to learn from the scriptures. We pray, Lord, that we will have a wonderful time, a blessed time, a time of being edified through the learning of the scriptures, that we will be able to learn about you, about your desires, about what we need to be doing so that you will be glad about us, that you will be happy about us, that we will fulfill your purposes in our lives. Commit all of us in your hands, everyone who's joined and everyone who's watching. Pray for your grace and blessings to continue upon us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. So once again, welcome. We are going to sing two songs, as we always do, and we are going to be exuberant in our praises. We are going to, because songs in themselves are supposed to be emotions, yes? So as human beings, we do have emotions, and we are going to use our emotions, be expressive in our gratitude to God, and let us glorify him. So along with the team, I would like you to stand up, join with us, join with them as we sing, as they sing, we also sing along with them. All right, so let us do that, and let's be exuberant in our praises.
God in my living, there in my breathing, God in my waking, God in my sleeping, God in my resting, there in my working, God in my thinking, God in my speaking, be my everything. Be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. God in my hoping, there in my dreaming, God in my watching, God in my waiting, God in my laughing, there in my weeping, God in my hurting, God in my healing, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory, you are everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory, for you are everything. You are everything, you are everything. You are everything, 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 you are everything. God in my hoping, there in my dreaming, God in my laughing, there in my weeping, God in my hurting, God in my healing, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. Everything, be my
That you sang along with the team. I hope that you enjoyed singing. So today we had Grace and Naveen who sang for us. We had Jasmine and Stephen who played the music for us. So as always, the team, they do a great job of singing and playing the music. So thanks a lot, guys. All right. So those of you who have joined in late, once again, welcome to our Sunday morning fellowship. All right. So we are going to jump right into the study of the scriptures. All right. So are you excited? Yeah, that is when we should be suffering. Hallelujah. The most exciting time. It should be. All right. So for people of God. All right. So don't walk away. Don't log off. Continue to watch and let's study from the scriptures. All right. So We have been doing a study of the book of Luke, as you already know, and it's been a wonderful study, edifying. We have been able to learn a lot of things. I hope that you have been able to do that. As I prepare for all of these things, as I study, I have been edified. So I hope that it's the same with you as well. All right. So we are going to look at Luke chapter 11 today. So please do turn in your Bibles. Do you have your Bibles in your hands? Please do turn in your Bibles to chapter 11 of Luke. Verses 1 onwards. One day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. Okay, so we have talked about Jesus praying at least a couple of times from the book of Luke, right? So it is very interesting because Jesus, why does Jesus pray? You know, many people really don't get the point of it. They think that that Jesus prayed so that he can be an example for us, that somehow we can follow him in praying. That's not exactly the case. We have already established this, but since we come to a passage like this, and it will be only right for us to talk about that, not at length, because if you want at length, go back to our previous videos and look at them, but just in a brief manner, what is this prayer all about? Why did Jesus pray? Isn't he God? And who's he praying to? So is it just so that we can follow in his footsteps and pray? This is something called perichoresis. We already know that the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, they are so in sync with each other. And the technical word is interpenetration, meaning they are so interpenetrated, that they are so in sync with each other, that relationship has always existed. God has always existed as a community. And now that the Son has stepped into history as a human being, and he continues that relationship with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And that is what is beautiful about this, that it is the existing relationship that the Son has with the Father and the Holy Spirit, which is brought out through this. And as always, as we have looked at, something that stands out, something that comes as a surprise and even as a shock, is that in all of these passages where it is mentioned that Jesus prayed, we don't sometimes the disciples are with him, sometimes they're not. But even when they are with him, they are just spectators. They don't pray together with Jesus Christ. In fact, he only at the Garden of Gethsemane, he would call and say, "Why don't you pray with me?" That's in a completely different context. And even there, they would be sleeping. All right. So Jesus never prayed with his disciples, and they never prayed along with him. As I said, in today's Christianity, that's what you need to. You always need to get together and pray. Okay, we'll come to that. So here, as always, they are just spectators. And why are they not involved? I mean, they don't even give so much importance to this, right? Because we need to understand that Israel's religion, why am I saying Israel's religion? We usually call it Judaism, right? But we need to understand that Judaism is a later concept, basically, because God, he created the created human beings, and then to Adam and Eve, then Noah, Abraham, he had revealed himself, and there is only one God, and he is the one true God, all right? So everything else, no other gods do exist, and therefore there is only one religion, if at all we can call it religion, following God. And what happens is through history, God has revealed himself, and you know, people follow him, some people don't, some people do. So what do we call that? Do we call that Israel's religion? Do we call that? We don't know. We don't have a name for that. But Judaism, it's not definitely Judaism. It's definitely not Judaism. What is Judaism? Judaism as a word, even the word Judah comes into existence, right? The nation of Judah, because we know the divided kingdom, right? Israel and Judah. Israel with 10 tribes, Judah with 2 tribes, Benjamin and Judah, and also the Levites there. We know that was later on, during monarchy, after Solomon's time. And this kingdom is called Judah. And now when Judah is being captured by Babylon, that is the time in which these people were called Jews. Before that, we don't have any mention of Jews. They were called Hebrews, the people were called Israelites, but these were the Jews. And the religion of the Jews is called Judaism. So that's somewhere, you know, after 586 BC, right? Because Babylonian captivity is 587, 586, 587 BC. So this is after that, just maybe 500 years before Christ. But the true religion or the true following has always been there right from the beginning. So can we call it Israel's religion? No, I mean, we can't call it Judaism, definitely. So I want you to understand the limitation of this word, but we will use it in a very broad sense, Judaism, that is God giving the Torah, God giving the law to the Israelites. In that, we find there is no demand ever by God to the people who follow him, saying you have to pray. There is no demand, absolutely no demand anywhere in the Torah where God said you have to pray. No commandment to pray, no demand to pray. And therefore, it's not something so very important to them, right? God, on the other hand, they understood that God did not demand prayer, God demanded worship. These are two different things. Okay, God demanded worship. What is worship? Worship, not the way we understand it today. You know, today we understand it. Worship means immediately songs and music. In our Bible studies, we have discussed that. And it's a very interesting study. Through the scriptures, you look at the words that refer to, that have been translated as worship in the Old Testament, you know, shaka, or in the New Testament, proskuneo, or any of those words, any word which has been translated as worship, you know, even in English Bible, go check it, you would find that it is not associated in any way with music or songs. It is always about bowing down before God, acknowledging him as God, obedient to him because he is God, serving him because he is God. So these are the ideas that are brought out through the word worship. So God always wanted his people, or the people who follow him, to worship him, and not this idea of prayer. And that's why I said Jesus was never praying with his disciples. You know, what is so very important today is, you know, whenever we talk about Christianity, it's all about prayer. But yeah, it is all about worship, meaning bowing down, obeying, serving. That is really the relationship that was there with people who truly followed God through the Old Testament, through the times that people really followed him. Of course, during those times, even though there is no commandment expressly saying you have to, because it's not a demand that God placed on them that they would pray, God demanded that they worship, but prayer was always a part of human beings' lives, right? So when people follow God, when people understand God, when they go through a problem, when there is anguish, when there is suffering, those are times when it becomes a venting out, an outburst of that sorrow, which is expressed, which comes out, and it's not pre-planned, it doesn't have to have structure. It's spontaneous outburst of those powerful, you know, feelings and emotions, and especially those of sorrow, anguish, and distress, and all of those things. So here we find Jesus' prayer is not that at all. It's basically the relationship that he has with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And this is the way, the human way, because he is human right now, the human way of connecting and relating and expressing his relationship with God. It's almost talking and conversing, you know. It's not about petitioning, but rather conversing. You know, in a relationship, you converse, you speak to the person, you share. And that is really what is happening here. So have you got the proper understanding of what prayer is, what Jesus did, and why these disciples are not praying with him, why Jesus never asked them to pray with him, Jesus never gave them a commandment saying you have to pray, why the Old Testament never gives a commandment saying you need to pray? It's a human thing. You don't have to be told to pray. It is just when you go through problems automatically, right, when a child is hungry, when the infant is hungry, automatically it cries. Why? It's spontaneous. When you have pain, you automatically cry. And that's human, but rather that's not the demand. We need to understand what the demand that God has placed on us. It is to bow down, to obey, to worship, in the sense of to serve. All right? So the prayer does not break or make a relationship. Right? Doesn't make a relationship to happen. Doesn't break the relationship if you don't pray. But rather, it is an expression. Why we are talking about this is because prayer has been misunderstood and distorted, and pagan understanding of prayer has crept into Christianity. And today, when people talk about prayer, this pagan understanding, the non-Christian, the non-biblical understanding, or rather, non-biblical idea of prayer has crept in. And that is why we are talking about this. But anyway, as I said, we have already talked about it. So go back, and if you want a in-depth understanding, to our other videos. So what does prayer do? You know, this is a question that some people ask when you say, hey, God has not given you, God does not he's not going to be offended if you don't pray, you know, God doesn't require you to pray. And then people say, then why do I have to pray? If my prayer is not going to make anything happen, why am I going to pray? Again, that would mean that it becomes a means to an end. Prayer is not a means to an end. It is the end, in the sense of it is about the relationship. So you have a relationship, it's about that conversation, and that's about that sharing that you have. All right. So, but today's Christians always talk about, you know, I have heard sermons where, you know, people are condemned, saying if you don't pray, you are a sinner, right? Because not praying is basically sin, which is punishable by God. Where? From where? Where do you get that? No. Not definitely not from the Bible, but these are the Christians who blaspheme God by their prayer. Just think about that, you know, and that is why Jesus was against these hypocrites who were the religious leaders of Jesus' times, who were always, you know, showing themselves to be prayerful. And Jesus would have no good words to talk about them, because they were just doing something which they thought was very spiritual, where people would think that they're very spiritual. In fact, they were demeaning God. They were blaspheming God, right? And because it's verbose, Jesus would be talking about how their prayer is verbose, meaning how long a prayer I pray, the length of the prayer, the words that I use. Even today, that is what the case is, right? How long did you pray? The self-importance in prayer, it's all about me, somehow I'm so close to God. The status lifting, where if I pray more, somehow people are going to think that I'm more spiritual, and I can be called a prayer warrior or very prayerful person. Are you an obedient person? Do you know God rightly? Are you serving God? Those are the questions that need to be asked, all right? So there is no mystical, magical power in prayer, at least according to the teachings of Jesus, or according to what we see through the scriptures. But it's definitely not a formula to change God, because today that is exactly what happens, right? And today, especially during this pandemic, or anything for that matter, if it's an election, immediately, come on, everybody, let's all pray together, because somehow it's magic. And pandemic is there, let's all come together and pray together, because somehow the more people gather together, somehow we are going to change God, okay? Because the majority wins. He's just one person, right? So if thousands and thousands and millions of people gather together, somehow we can change God. He is sovereign. Don't try to change him. Hallelujah. Your prayer is not to change God. Your prayer does not, you know, intercession. Just think about this. You know, today people talk about intercession. You know, pick out a verse from the Bible where it says, if my people who have my name will humble themselves and pray, and then I will bring blessing and healing to their land. What exactly is that? He is talking about the people of Israel, everybody who knew him, and they are walking away from him. And God says, if you come back, then you are going to be blessed. Not in a heterogeneous situation like ours, right? If my people called by my name, I mean, the whole nation is not his people who are called by his name, and they never belonged to him. Completely different. So it is basically vilifying God, as though, you know, if we don't all come together and somehow cry and pray, he is not going to do anything. He is sovereign. He is good. He knows what he is doing. He has all the authority and right and power to do what he wills and what he thinks is right and what he knows is right. Not just thinks, he knows is right, because he is good, he is holy, he is righteous. And don't ever presume to command him. Don't ever presume to change him. Don't ever presume to think that you are better than him, forcing God into action. As I said, these people who call themselves, oh, so spiritual, I'm so prayerful, the prayer in itself has become a blasphemy, where you show yourselves to be a better person than God himself is. Somehow he is not very good, and I am so good. I have so much concern for my nation, for the people who are dying. And therefore, Lord, won't you look at them? I am a very soft-hearted person. You are a hard-hearted person. I have to intercede because I'm so very important. Unless I recommend, you know, you're not going to do anything. What kind of a depiction of God are you doing? Be very careful. Yes, Jesus prayed, but it's a completely kind of different kind of a prayer. His disciples, yeah, that's they didn't even pray. That's because they are Jewish understanding. The Torah is teaching them something very different. It's about obedience. So, shouldn't you pray? If you have a problem, whom else could you go to? Right, you open up, and not just when you have a problem, let it be a relationship. And in the relationship, how does that relationship happen? Not by a prayer, but by your really understanding and acknowledging the truth, obeying the truth, and being obedient to Him and serving Him. That's how the relationship happens. Because you are a child of God, because now you have that relationship, in that relationship, you have all the liberty to share and converse and do all these things. All right, so have a relationship with God. Don't think that this is what is going to make that relationship happen. Or never ever through you are somehow your prayer, you are, sometimes we need to know that we blaspheme God through our understanding of prayer. Never do that. Okay, so that's, yeah, already I have spoken for 15 minutes. Which I said, I will not. I said, go back and look at the videos. Okay, but anyway, I have so much to say. And so this is the relationship. This the first part is about the relationship that Jesus has with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And that is why this prayer is not an example for us to follow. It does not give us a teaching about prayer as to what prayer does, as we have already established that prayer is just an expression within the relationship. Your relationship is not based on the sharing. Your relationship is based on you obeying and doing and being humble and knowing His purpose and the truth and proclaiming it. That's what is so important, relationship. So let's be like Jesus in that. Yes, He is a part of the Trinity. We are not a part of the Trinity, but let our relationship be about obedience and so on. All right. But we know that Judaism later on had brought in all these rituals, and I don't have much time to explain all those things. Maybe some other time we will look at that, about how Judaism had become a completely different religion during the times of Jesus, where, you know, mystical, magical things have, you know, asceticism, mysticism, and all of those things have crept in. All right. And then let's look at that. We just looked at one part of it, right? When He finished, one of His disciples said to Him, so they are spectators, they are just looking at Him. What is He doing? All right. Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught His disciples. They want to learn to pray. As I said, as though it's a skill to be learned, as though it's a formula that needs to be learned. We have already said, hey, prayer is it doesn't have a format. It's spontaneous. It's basically an outburst of whatever is going on in you. It's what is foremost in your mind. It's basically sharing and conversing and all of those things. Someone needs to teach you to do that. You know, we need to learn from you. What are they saying? So their understanding of prayer is completely distorted. It's not the real understanding of what God wanted them to have. So as I said, Judaism has corrupted their minds, corrupted them, distorted the idea. As I said, this Judaism which has come into existence has become mystical, and you know, these are formulas that you need to do. These are practices and rituals that you have to do, and prayer becomes one of the rituals there, whereby you somehow please God, right? So this is definitely not the biblical idea, but the disciples, because of the times, during the times that they lived in, this is the Judaism that they were a part of, and they had been influenced by this, and therefore their understanding of prayer is not really good. And now they come and say, Lord, teach us how to pray. And what did they want to why did they want to pray? What is the reason that they are giving? Why do we want to pray? Just as John taught His disciples. So John had taught His disciples to pray, and Jesus, teach us, your disciples, to pray. It's almost like a competition. John's disciples were taught by John how to pray, but us, Lord, we don't know how to pray. And another thing is that two of John's disciples, right when John the Baptist, you're talking about John the Baptist, John the Baptist as he showed declared publicly, saying, this is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, right? He's the Lamb that's going to take away the sins of the world. Immediately, two of his disciples, John's disciples, followed Jesus. They became the disciples of Jesus. Who were they? One we definitely know is Andrew. The other one we're not really sure about. His name is not mentioned. Most probably it was John, right? So anyway, Andrew and John, most probably. So they are the followers. So either, and it looks like these guys have been disciples of John. Maybe John had taught his disciples how to pray. And the other 10, maybe they feel left out. Among ourselves, these two guys have been taught by John and they know how to pray. But 10 of us, we feel very left out. Teach us how to pray. So why do you need to pray? Why do you need to learn to pray? I mean, why do you even need to learn to pray? As though it's a formula, because John taught, you have not taught. We are your disciples, but John's disciples know, we don't know. And a couple of John's disciples are here, they know, we don't know. So it looks like more of, as I said, the very context is so humorous. Do you get the humor? When you read it, do you see the humor? Yeah, when I explain it, do you see the humor? Yeah, okay. It's so very humorous that you can't even take these guys' requests so very seriously. And it's typical of Luke. I don't know whether he does it intentionally. Through his writings, Luke seems to be portraying the disciples of Jesus, because Luke was not the disciple, not a disciple of Jesus. He somehow has a laugh. Yes, he somehow seems to have a laugh at these guys, the disciples. And more often than not, you would find that they are picturized as people who really did not understand. And they are portrayed in a very humorous manner. So maybe Luke is having a laugh at them. But the context is humorous and funny. Yeah. All right. So as though prayer is a competition, this is how it is for us too, right? So prayer is a competition. So it's basically, yeah, how long do you pray? How long do I pray? So who's the best, who's more closer to God now? Yeah, and not only the length of the prayer. Yeah, when you prayed, did you kneel down and pray, or were you standing and praying? Okay, yeah, that basically, you know, is very important, right? So, yeah, it's a competition. So did you cry? Did you cry when you were praying, or were you not crying? Okay, so more marks to me. Right, so because I cried, I was kneeling down, I prayed like, you know, a long time. This is become a competition, I know, right? I've heard messages and sermons where, you know, I see, as a child, I was whatever the pastor said, whatever the preacher said, it was God's word to me, and that's how I grew up. But now, when I look back, yeah, it is humorous. So the pastor used to say, you know, if you don't shed a single tear during your prayer, then your prayer is basically a waste, right? And God is not going to listen, because he is going to keep account of how much tears you shed, and it's all in his account. So if you don't shed tears, then there is no account. Basically, there is no tab, you know, next to your name which records all of those things. Yeah, what? So it's basically a competition, right? The length of the prayer, you know, kneeling down and weeping and shedding tears. So now it is basically who gets to make more people pray, right? That's the competition right now, I guess, right? Who makes more people to pray together? So is it 1,000 people? Is it lack of people? Is it more? Who gets more crowd to pray together? And that's a competition. So that means, I am a better, you know, pastor or a leader or an evangelist. It's all a competition. So when we look at these guys, why did they want to pray? Because John taught his disciples to pray. Lord, we don't know. It's basically a competition. It's about reputation. It's not about the relationship. It's not about venting something out in the relationship. Earlier we said, see, for us, it's completely different. It's not even about the relationship. It's about vilifying God. We don't say we vilify God, but somehow through our prayer, we show ourselves to be most wonderful people. I pray for my nation, Lord. Won't you see? Won't you become soft-hearted? Won't you look down? Won't you be gracious? Won't you be merciful? Newsflash, He is all of those things, and you are none of those things in comparison to who He is. His goodness, His holiness, His righteousness, His sovereignty, His love, His compassion, His goodness. So who are we elevating? And now, the competition in, you know, who knows to pray better. Our reputation should be based not on how much we pray or the length of the prayer or this or that. Our reputation should be based on whether we know the truth, whether we obey the truth, whether we proclaim the truth. So what is our reputation based on? It's not about knowing some kind of a flowery prayer, but it's about knowing the truth. It's about obeying the truth. It's about proclaiming the truth. That is what we need to be focusing on, right? So prayer is a private affair. Don't make it public, as Jesus himself would say to these hypocritical, the Jewish leaders and the religious leaders of that time. As I said, Judaism has become something very different with the Talmud, with the what's that called, with the Midrash. You've heard these words? Okay, we will explain that some other time. With all that has crept in, and people have become all mystic and emotional and sensational, superstition, and all that, those things have crept in. And now, their prayer, they say, oh, prayer is something pleasing to God, and they want to do it at marketplaces. Jesus says, no, if at all you pray, you go and shut the door in your room and you pray there. So it is not, it's a private affair. Don't make it public. If at all, you know, what needs to be made public is knowing the truth. That needs to be made public. Teaching the truth. Yes, that needs to be made public. Obeying the truth. Yes, this is the truth. I want to obey the truth. Make it public. Proclamation of the truth. Make it public. Not your prayer. That's not a competition. Right. So, teach us to pray. That's what these disciples say. So we talked about the relationship. We talked about the reputation. Somehow they think, oh, it's going to build our reputation now. Let's move on. And then Jesus says, he said to them, when you pray, say, Father. Okay, this is beautiful. So how he starts this. So yes, is it about the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, the title that has been given to these three persons within the true Trinity, where he is talking about the Father, right? As the first person of the Trinity, and the title, is he talking about that? Or is he talking about how our relationship with God is, that he is our Father in the sense of he is our life giver? So it's a patriarchal society. All obviously, we know that the father and mother, they both take equal responsibility in bringing a life into the world, even though life belongs to God. But anyway, the point is, Father, you know, that he becomes the source of our life. He becomes the cause of our life. So when we say Father, it's basically that you are the creator, that I, as a child, am existing because of you. So is it the title, or is it more to do with the relationship? It's more to do with the reality of this relationship. Jesus brings it out beautifully. So, but what we really understand is that we need to acknowledge him as God. That's the important thing. You know, when Jesus says, he teaches how to pray, Jesus says, acknowledge him as God. And if you acknowledge him as God, then we need to understand our obligation and duty towards him. If you acknowledge him as God, then immediately what happens is, the implication is that I understand my obligation and my duty towards him. If he is, you know, in the modern age, that doesn't happen, right? So nobody is responsible for anything, right? So even in relationships. So the child has no responsibility towards the parent has no responsibility towards the child. No, that cannot be. In the relationship, there is a duty, there is obligation, there is responsibility. Jesus says, if you call him God, if you call him Father, then understand that you as a child has a responsibility, a duty, an obligation to fulfill, right? So as we have already talked about something like when we call God the Lord, immediately we are saying that we are the slaves. If he is the kurios, then we are the doulos. He is God, he is the Lord, he is the master, then I am the slave. That relationship, that that dynamic, that obligation, that duty is always there. And Jesus beautifully brings it up. So how do I pray? How Lord teach us to pray? Jesus says, acknowledge him as God. And if he is God, know your duty and obligation. So it is not just the formula that you go on reciting this again and again. Yes, knowing the Lord's Prayer. We already have it in Matthew chapter 6, right? So we already have an in-depth study of Matthew chapter 6 elsewhere. So go ahead and look at that. But Luke, it's a kind of a shortened form, or maybe it's a different instance altogether where Jesus is saying this. But anyway, in this passage, we find this, that Jesus makes it very brief and he clarifies, saying a prayer is not just, it's not about your reputation. Prayer is about you acknowledging him as God and you being obedient and dutiful. All right. Then he says, Father, hallowed be your name. What does it mean? Hallowed meaning holy, meaning sacred. Sacred be your name. So my prayer is making God holy. My prayer is making him sacred. No, it means that I acknowledge. So when I say, Father, I acknowledge that you are God. When I say, hallowed be your name, it is not through my prayer, your name is hallowed, right? So, you know, hallowed is basically that he is made, it's about holiness. So my prayer is not making him holy. And that's what I said. Our understanding of prayer is this. Our prayer makes him good. Our prayer makes him righteous. And our prayer makes him gracious. Our prayer makes him merciful. Because if you don't pray, he is going to be a hard-hearted God who is just going to look at all the pain. Or sometimes he does not even know that. So you have to go and inform him, Lord, don't you know? Don't you see what my people are going through? As I said, you know, you are the soft-hearted person and he is the hard-hearted person. Don't you know? And if you know, why are you not doing anything? Do something. I intercede. Okay. All that kind of, it's not crazy talk. I think that's a very cunning, very blasphemous, very ungodly talk. All right. So... Right. So what exactly is happening here is that hallowed be your name. My prayer is not making him hallowed. I am acknowledging that he is. His name is hallowed. I am acknowledging that he has to be treated as holy, that God needs to be treated as God and not as our personal genie. Because as we have already looked at many a time, this is what it is. Lord, you do this. Lord, you do that. Lord, you save India. Lord, you heal me. Lord, you heal India. Lord, you do this. Lord, you do that. If he is God, don't presume to command him. You can't make him holy. You acknowledge his holiness. You acknowledge that he is God. Treat him as God. Let God be God. Hallelujah. Yeah. Don't usurp his throne. He is God, right? Otherwise, we will be Satan. And that's what, not clearly through the scriptures, but at least the basic understanding is that he rebelled against God. What is rebellion? That you want to overthrow him, that you want to have his glory for yourself. Don't treat him as though he is someone that you have to command. Treat him as God, because he is God. He is the sovereign Lord. He's not your personal genie to go about doing your fulfilling your whims and fancies and your wishes, where he comes out and says, your wish is my command. You do these, you say to him, Lord, your wish is my command. Not to him. He doesn't have to say, oh, your wish is my command. Oh, you want this? Oh, let me do it. Because he is basically the servant and you are the master. He, let his name be hallowed. And so, as I said, don't presume to think that you know better, or somehow you feel feel more than he does, right? Because that is our way of talk and our way of prayer, that somehow we know better. If at all we are God, somehow we will, you know, do something better than what he is doing now. He is not our ruler or a king or a prime minister or so on, whom you say, hey, this guy does not know what he is doing. He is God. Don't think that you know better than he does. Don't think that you somehow have more empathy than he does. He feels more. He knows better. And... so worship him as God, serve him as slaves, and never ever say not what he will do, but the question always should be what I should be doing. because that's the important thing. He is the Father, the giver of my life. His name is hallowed. So it is not let your name be hallowed. No, I know that your name is hallowed, and I acknowledge that, and I submit myself. And then he goes on, your kingdom come. So again, this is not through your prayer, somehow you are ushering in the kingdom of God. Otherwise, Jesus would have said, told his disciples, the 12 and the 72 and all of those people, pray that the kingdom of God will be established. No, he would be saying that the kingdom needs to be established, and you go and establish the kingdom. Go and preach the message of the kingdom. So when we say, let your kingdom come, it is not basically through our words that are so powerful that when we say, let your kingdom come, immediately the kingdom is going to be established. No, no, no. It is basically acknowledging that this is your desire, Lord. Your kingdom being established is your desire. And I want to be instrumental. I want to play my role and my part in that. So as I said, this whole thing is about recognition of who God is. He is the Father, and therefore it's my obligation to obey him. He is holy, and therefore it is my obligation to treat him as God and serve him and respect him and revere him. Hallowed be your name, we say. Your kingdom come. It is not basically, through my prayer, your kingdom comes, but rather that this is your will that your kingdom be established, and we will do our part and our role in doing that. This is the will of God, which needs to become our desire as well. So as we pray, let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Here it's not about the will be done. It just says your kingdom come. But again, it's all the same. The kingdom of God is God's will. And it's not just about the prayer. It's about what I do about that. That everybody knows God rightly, that everybody obeys his commandments. And isn't that what the Great Commission is all about? Where he said, you know, go into the world, make disciples, teach them to observe what I have commanded, teach them to obey what I have commanded you. That is how the kingdom is established. Go and teach people to obey what he has commanded us to do, right? And that is our mission, all right? So the reverence that we have, the recognition of who he is and our role and our responsibility. Let's continue. Give us our daily bread. So the first part is basically reverence and recognition also. Here, give us our daily bread. So is that telling him because he does not know to give us our daily bread, or he doesn't care enough for us that he would give us our daily bread? Is that so? No. Again, this is an acknowledgement of our daily bread comes from him. Hallelujah. That if I receive food, that's because of him. And that's the acknowledgement here, where I say the food that I get, the bread that I get, is because of you. So it's more of an acknowledgement rather than a petition. You got it? Yes, no? Okay. Yeah, I'm talking to the camera. Through the camera to you. And let's go on. What else is there? Forgive us. So again, this is not telling God to forgive, but rather an acknowledgement of the forgiveness we receive from him. So give us our daily bread. It's an acknowledgement that our daily bread we receive from him. Forgive us our sins. Our sins are forgiven, and we acknowledge that through him, in him, we have forgiveness. And for we also forgive. What does it say? For we also forgive everyone who sins against us. So this is not kind of blackmailing God and saying, hey, I'm forgiving everybody. Why don't you forgive? No, no, no. That's not what it is. And this is an acknowledgement of him being forgiving, and also a teaching that I receive that I also should forgive, right? So I am forgiving because you have forgiven me. So the whole idea here is not telling God what to do, but rather acknowledging and revering him and recognizing who God is and what God does. Do not lead us into temptation. As I said, again, this is not a petition, because he is not going to lead us into temptation. We are the ones who lead ourselves into temptation, because temptation does not come from God, because temptation leads to sin. And temptation is basically from our own selves, that we want to sin and we want to go away. But God is saying, no, he is helping us not to do that. So we find that not being led into temptation in itself is from God. So we acknowledge that our daily bread is from him, that our forgiveness is from him, that us not falling into temptation is because of him. All right? So what is prayer? I mean, they ask, Lord, teach us how to pray. And Jesus says, acknowledge that he is the Father. Acknowledge that his name is hallowed. Acknowledge that his kingdom needs to come. Acknowledge that the food that you have, comes from him. Acknowledge that the forgiveness that you receive comes from him. Acknowledge that you having not fallen into temptation is because of him. So is that prayer? According to Jesus, that's prayer. But our prayer, as I said, completely different. So we talked about, what did we talk about? We talked about the relationship that Jesus had, and that is why the prayer, and these guys remain spectators. And now they come and say, John taught his disciples to pray, teach us to pray. It's about the reputation. Jesus says, no, it's not about the reputation. Then Jesus goes on to tell them what prayer is. It's about this reverence to God and this recognition of all these things that we receive up from God. So let's call it reverence or recognition. Then he goes on. Then Jesus said to them, suppose you have a friend and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need.
Yeah, earlier he said, hey, this is how you pray, right? You have reverence towards God. You recognize what all that you have received from God. And now, how is this related? They said, teach us to pray. So he finished teaching them to pray and he goes on to something else. No, it looks like he is talking about the same thing. It's almost like a very cryptic kind of a parable, and Jesus is known for that. That he could be the most cryptic person ever, trying to, you know, he was a wonderful communicator, but sometimes, why is he speaking in riddles? And he gives a hypothetical situation here, right? So what is the hypothetical situation? You have a friend, and another friend has traveled and come to you at night, and you don't have anything to offer. So you go to your another friend who is already asleep, you knock at his door, and says, my friend has come, you know, give me some food, I don't have anything there. And that friend says, I've already locked the door, my children are sleeping, I can't get up and give it. But you keep on knocking. And that friend says, okay, I am giving not because you are a friend, but I give it to you because you don't have any shame at all. In the night, I am sleeping, my children are sleeping, and you keep on knocking. And because of that shameless audacity, because I don't want to be disturbed anymore, I give. So there are 3 friends here, right? They are friends? Okay. They seem to be very inconsiderate. The first friend needs bread for his friend because he doesn't have anything. He asks the second friend during the night when everyone has gone to bed. He is considerate of the friend who has come to visit him, but he is not considerate of the trouble he is causing to the friend who is asleep. Is he a good friend? Okay. The one inside doesn't want to be bothered. He is considerate of his family. My children are sleeping. I don't want them to be woken up, and I don't want them to lose their sleep. So I'm not going to give anything. My family is important. Your friendship, not so much. And then he makes a decision. I might not give you because I care, but I will give because you won't stop disturbing me. A good friend? Right, all the three seem to be inconsiderate. The one who traveled also, we don't know about him. So he traveled and came at night, disturbing the guy. He doesn't have food. Jesus, you know, on the spot, he just comes up with this hypothetical situation. Why did Jesus tell this? What was he trying to teach? What is the point of the story? And the point, you know, what is Jesus trying to say? That he is very creative, that, you know, at the on the spot, he can come up with a story, such a tricky, cryptic story. So is that what Jesus wanted to teach? Yeah, that is also brought out, that he is very creative. He was very quick thinking. Immediately, he just, you know, makes up a story on the spot. Is this friend, the one you know, who's sleeping, a reference to God? Because immediately, you know, anything, we will just take it and say, you know, this is how God is. That he might not want to give, but because you keep on asking, he is giving. Are you depicting God as good person or bad person? In this story, this guy who didn't want to wake up, and then he doesn't even consider that friendship to be of any value. All that he wants is, I don't want to be disturbed anymore. Because of your shameful audacity, I'll open up my door and give you. Not because I care. Is that a good guy? What do you think? I mean, is he a good friend? Yeah, maybe he had his own problems. This guy is insensitive. That guy is also insensitive. The other guy is also insensitive. So none of them are really considerate. And you have the audacity, we have the audacity, to compare God to that guy who says, I will give because I'm, you know, you keep on disturbing. So we want to be like this disturbing friend, and God is that disturbed friend. Okay, not disturbed, but, you know, the one who is being disturbed right now. That doesn't definitely do justice to God. And then people keep on saying, you know, pray until something happens. You know, I have heard series of sermons on that. You know, push, you know, P-U-S-H, pray until something happens. Okay. Pray until something happens. Meaning, that's Jacob's prayer. He went on being persistent. And, you know, he got what he wanted. Yeah, I don't care what God wants. Because I'm the sovereign. You know, he needs to do what I want him to do. He is not God. I am God. Just think about that. Anyway, is that a good depiction of God? Is he portrayed as good? Because if he is good, he would just give. Is he portrayed as merciful and compassionate? Otherwise, he would automatically do. Is he portrayed as selfless? No, he seems to be very selfish. So there is no comparison between this guy who helped because of this shameless audacity to God. We can never compare it. So why? What is Jesus actually saying here? Why this cryptic passage, this hypothetical situation? Interesting? Yeah, I find it interesting. Let's move on. Then he goes on. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Again, another cryptic passage. What is Jesus trying to say here? So I say to you, ask and it will be given. We know this passage. Seek and you will find. Knock and the doors will be opened. And look at the grammar. Look at the passive voice that he is using. What is this passive voice? Who is going to open the door? Who is going to ask and it will be given? He's not saying ask and God will give. Seek and God will give you. Knock and God will open. No. Ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened. Okay, so who's the person who is doing that? He is not talking about God here. Okay, what's Jesus trying to say? For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. He is just talking about the general principle that the world operates on. In a very general sense, okay, you ask, you get. You keep searching for something, you find. You knock at a door, they open it. So it is basically, Jesus is talking about the general principle of how things are. Again, we cannot just take it and make it an absolute principle. So it is not, because that would become untrue. You didn't get because you didn't ask. You didn't find because you didn't seek. You didn't. It was not open to you because you didn't knock. You know, sometimes you no matter how much you knock, nothing happens. No matter how much you seek, nothing, you find nothing. No matter how much you ask, right? You don't get anything. Okay. So that is all there. Huh? So not receiving and not finding and not being allowed is not the fault of the subject. So what is Jesus talking about? Yeah, he's, as I said, it's about the general principle. This is how the world is. So, and he goes on. Which of you, fathers, if your son asks you fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, okay, let's stop there. So then he goes on to another one. Which of you fathers, if your son asks you for a fish, will you give him a snake? If he asks for an egg, will you give a scorpion? So he is saying that not even a good father, any father for that matter, would not be giving poisonous reptiles to his son when he is asked food, right? So what is the point of this discourse? Is he comparing this father, the father, to God and these sons to us? What is Jesus doing? Is he saying that we need to ask so that we can receive from God? Let's move on. If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So he's not talking about how you need to ask him. He is talking about how you need to know the character and nature of God. It's not about the comparison, because he's saying, you evil people, if you know how to do good, won't God know how to do good? So he's established that your prayer is not going to make him good. If you guys, you evil people, are able to do some good, the good God, will he not do good? So your prayer is not making God good. So that's the point of this whole story, where he is saying that maybe in the world that you live in, you ask, you get, you knock at something, it opens, you seek, you find. But when it comes to God, and you evil people are able to do that, you know, you evil person, when you knock at that evil person's door, that evil person opens it up for you. When you ask an evil person, that evil person gives to you. And God is nothing like that evil person. He is already good. That's what Jesus is saying. It's not about asking. What is it about? It's about knowing the character and the will of God. Jesus wanted his disciples to seek something more than that. And what is he asking them to ask for? Look at this. And out of the blues, it just comes there where it says, where Jesus says, if you evil people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So there is no mention of the Holy Spirit before. All of a sudden, as I said, out of the blues, he says, will he not give you the Holy Spirit if you ask him? So what is this? They were saying, teach us to pray. He never answered that. He said, you have to acknowledge, you have to, what is that? Yes, you have to recognize what God has done. You have to be reverent to God. All that he said. Then he came up with this cryptic, hypothetical situation where he said that, there is the inconsiderate friend, the evil person, even the evil person does some good, and then he continues with the same line of thought, even an evil person does good. So what is he teaching them to pray? He is just saying, God is already good. Your prayer is not about making him good. And this is something that you need to learn. But to the ones who seek the Holy Spirit, ask for the Holy Spirit, he gives it. What does it mean? And what did the disciples understand by that? What was the teaching that Jesus gave about the Holy Spirit? If you go through the scriptures, I'm not going to take a lot of time, just a couple of things. Jesus had already taught them that the Holy Spirit has always been taught as someone who teaches what Jesus taught us, reminds us of what Jesus taught us, convicts us of our sins. He teaches us to, even when we are persecuted, to stand strong in him. And that is why Jesus would say, you know, when you are put on trial, you don't have to worry about it. The Holy Spirit will give you the words, meaning that you will have the boldness. And that's what, so to be persecuted, and even when you are persecuted, not to recant. He empowers you to be his witnesses. These are the words that Jesus uses for the Holy Spirit. That he will remind you of what I have taught you. He will convict you of sin based on what I taught you. He will empower you to be my witnesses. And when you are put on trial, he will give you the words. So, what is this Holy Spirit all about? He is saying that you need to be asking God that you will be reminded of the teachings of Jesus, that you will be convicted of sin, that you will be taught and empowered by the Holy Spirit. And this should be your prayer. John taught his disciples to pray. Lord, teach us to pray. Jesus says, if at all you have a desire, this should be the desire. Not making God good, but acknowledging that he is already good, and everything that you receive, the food that you get, the forgiveness that you get, that you having not fallen into temptation is because of him. Acknowledging that he is the Father, the life giver. Acknowledging that it is his name is holy and hallowed. And acknowledging that his kingdom needs to come. all that you do. And then he says, never think of as though your prayer has to make him good. He is already good. Your prayer, your desire should be, Lord, I need to remember your teachings, Jesus. The Holy Spirit does that. I need to be convicted when I do something wrong through the teachings of Jesus. I need to witness, be your witnesses to the world, to about you, of you to the world. And I need to do that. And when I'm doing that, when I'm put on trial, that I will still cling on to you and speak your words. And that should be your prayer, is what Jesus is saying. Now, you got the right definition of prayer? So, quite a lengthy passage. But have you got the line of the train of thought that Jesus is talking about? Let us be people who, if at all we, you know, our prayer, let it be like this, or let our desire be this. So it is not a ritualistic prayer that we have. It is not for reputation that we have this, to build our reputation that we have a prayer, but rather to recognize, to be reverent to him, to recognize what he has done, and also to relish in this, that we will, that what is our, what should be our, what should be something that we relish in, something that we are so happy about. This should be our desire. Lord, I need to remember your teachings. Lord, I need to be convicted by your teachings. Lord, I need to take your teachings to the world. Lord, when I'm put on trial because of your teachings, that I will still continue to speak your word. And that should be your desire. John taught his disciples to pray. That doesn't really matter. This should be your desire, is what Jesus said. So have you got a whole picture of what Jesus is saying? Hope that it makes sense. So let us be people who change our understanding of prayer, our misunderstanding of prayer, and have the right understanding of what Jesus says is prayer. Or rather, he uses their words, but he is actually talking about his will and his purpose and his desire is that his disciples will have this desire of being taught, of being convicted, of going and proclaiming the gospel, of standing strong even when they are put on trial because of the truth that they proclaim. That is the desire. And Jesus always has a habit of not addressing the questions that they ask, sometimes they are just silly questions according to Jesus. He goes beyond that and gives them an answer which is much more important. He gives them, maybe the question is different, but the answer is going to be something that they need to hear. Teach us to pray. Jesus says, I will teach you to have this desire, and this desire God will fulfill in your hearts. Do we have that desire? Let's bow down our heads and look to the Lord in prayer. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for helping us to gather together as a church online. We thank you that you have helped us to look at this passage and learn from the scriptures. Lord, we have misunderstood, distorted, and brought in the pagan understanding of prayer into Christianity. Help us, Lord, that the question is not how to pray, what to pray. The question is whether we are reverent to you, that we acknowledge that you are the life giver, that we are reverent to you in that we consider you to be God and not presume to tell you what to do, command you what to do, that you are holy, that your kingdom come. That should be our desire. That's your will. That should be our desire. That we will acknowledge that our food, our health, our jobs, our income, everything comes from you, that our forgiveness comes from you, that if we have not fallen, it's because of you. Acknowledge that is what you want us to do. Jesus, that is what you taught us, your disciples. And Lord, it is not about you that we ask can make you good and somehow you become merciful because of our prayers, because of our persistent prayer. But rather, acknowledging that you are already good and all that we have to desire is that your desire should become our desire, that us being taught the teachings of Jesus, that we being convicted of our sins by your teachings, that we teaching your teachings, proclaiming your teachings, and as we face problems when we proclaim the gospel and the teaching, that we will still stand strong. And that is your desire. Help us to acknowledge that And this is the answer that you wanted your disciples to learn. This is what you wanted them to learn. This is what we learn as well. Commit all of us to your hands. Everyone who is watching right now, every member of the church, every one of our friends and family members and all of us, and every believer and every person who is around us, our neighbors, we pray for everyone. Lord, our prayer is not to inform or to instruct or make you good. It is what is in our hearts, in our relationship with you, in our obedience, in our service to you. We also express our desires, and this is our desire. We pray that you will continue to bless us, and we pray that you will help us to know this truth and acknowledge this and live according to it. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. So I hope that you were edified through the study of the scriptures. Once again, thank you for joining us. And before you leave, kindly be very generous in giving your tithe, your offerings, and your contributions towards the church and the ministry, because that is an obligation that you have towards the kingdom work. And please do be generous. Do send your offerings, tithes, and contributions to the church account. So with that, we close our service for today. So please do remain safe. Have a great week. Have a wonderful day. God bless you all. Thank you.